Amen. Well, have a seat. Glad you could be here tonight. We are going through all of the things that I think that everybody who's following Jesus, everyone who's a Christian, there's certain stuff that you really need to know. And for some of it, it might be new, but an awful lot of it is just reminders of the things that the Bible teaches us about life and about God. And tonight, we're talking about the devil or Satan or Lucifer and demons and temptation and spiritual warfare, all of those kinds of things. So I hope you got one of the handouts. So if you'd like, you can take notes, or the study is being recorded, and you can always get it later if you need to review it. But I just want to jump right into this. The devil's real. He isn't made up. He's not a metaphor for all evil. He's the reason behind all evil to a huge degree. And if you think that the devil is just non-existent, just a guy in a red suit with a pitchfork or something, then chances are he's just going to be running all over you. At the same time, he's not somebody that we should be afraid of. He's not something that we should be thinking that he's behind every bush and that we're constantly, you know, binding Satan and all that kind of stuff. The Bible doesn't teach us to live that way either, but God just wants us to know the reality of the battle that we are in and how we can win that battle. So let's look at a few key scriptures. Genesis 3 is the first time we see the devil in the Bible, and he's called the serpent. And it says in Genesis chapter 3, verse 1, the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, to Eve, has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And she said, no, we can eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but the fruit of the tree that's in the middle of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die. And the serpent said to the woman, you will not surely die. Basically, God lied to you. For God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. She gave it to Adam and he ate as well. Their eyes were open, they knew they were naked, they covered up with fig leaves. And then God showed up, and God called to Adam in verse 9 and said, where are you? Adam and Eve had hidden, and he said, I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. And so Adam went on to blame Eve. Eve blamed the serpent. As you read the rest of the chapter, God cursed each of them for their disobedience. But his curse on the serpent was, you know, that he would one day, that he, you know, that the seed of the woman would crush the head of the serpent. In Genesis 3:15 there, that what we call the proto-evangelism, the first story of what Satan did here on the earth, but it's also the first declaration by God that someday the woman's seed, Jesus, would end up destroying him. Now, a couple of Old Testament passages that we can look at quickly as well, because although Genesis 3 is the first thing we see of the devil in human history, very early, obviously, right after Adam and Eve had been created and put into the garden, but in Isaiah 14 and in Ezekiel 28, two passages that seem to go back before Genesis and to tell the story of the devil, the enemy. And so first of all, let's go to Isaiah chapter 14. And he says, beginning with verse 12, how you are fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning, how you are cut down to the ground, you who weakened the nations. For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation on the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Satan was someone who, as we'll also find out, was an exalted angel. But that wasn't enough for him. He wanted to be greater than God. His pride was puffing him up. And so you see all of these I will statements. And in verse 15, yet you shall be brought down to Sheol, to hell, to the lowest parts of the pit. Those who see you will gaze at you and consider you, saying, is this the man who made the earth tremble, who shook kingdoms, who made the world as a wilderness and destroyed its cities, who didn't open the house of his prisoners, and so on. Now turn over to Ezekiel chapter 28. And you can go back and read these passages if you want to pick up more of the details. We have a lot of ground to cover, obviously. In Ezekiel 28, there's a prophecy against a guy who's, it seems like it's a guy who is an actual human leader in Tyre. But then he turned and he's talking about the prince of Tyre, but then in verse 12, he seems to shift and talks about the king of Tyre, the one who really was the power behind this evil place. And he says, take up a lamentation for the king of Tyre and say to him, thus says the Lord God, you were the seal of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering. Names all those precious stones. The workmanship of your timbrels and pipes. Apparently, he was involved in music and playing beautiful sounds. Was prepared for you on the day you were created. You were the, verse 14, the anointed cherub, the angel who covers, a leading angel. I established you. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked back and forth in the midst of fiery stones. You were perfect in your ways from the day you were created until iniquity was found in you. By the abundance of your trading or by your wheeling and dealing, you became filled with violence within and you sinned. Therefore, I cast you as a profane thing out of the mountain of God, and I destroyed you, O covering cherub, from the midst of the fiery stones. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. You corrupted your wisdom for the sake of your splendor. I cast you to the ground. I laid you before kings that they might gaze at you. You defiled your sanctuaries by the multitude of your iniquities, by the iniquity of your trading. Therefore, I brought fire from your midst. It devoured you, and I turned you to ashes upon the earth in the sight of all who saw you. All who knew you among the peoples are astonished at you. You've become a horror and shall be no more forever. And so he's describing an angelic being who was a prominent leader among the angels. Beautiful, creative, but egotistical. And how he was tossed down from heaven, and how someday he will be reduced to nothing and judged completely. Those are some of the stories in the Old Testament to describe this character that we call the devil or Satan. And then kind of in Revelation 12, John gives us sort of an overall description of the career of the devil. And so it's another passage that we should look at in this regard. People differ on exactly how to interpret some of this, but it seems to me to be talking about this battle that has gone on between the devil and between Jesus. And so it talks about a woman who has a child and cries out in labor. But in verse 3, another sign appeared in heaven, a great fiery red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns, 7 diadems. His tail drew a third of the stars of heaven and threw them to the earth. It's thought that he got a third of the angels to go with him and turn against God. And the dragon stood before the woman who was ready to give birth to devour her child as soon as it was born. She bore a male child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron, and her child was caught up to God and his throne. The devil stood there wanting to destroy him, but he ended up being caught up into heaven. The woman fled into the wilderness where she has a place prepared by God, describing Israel who was protected during, would be protected during the time of the tribulation. So again, if you read on through the passage, the great dragon in verse 9 was cast out, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And then I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, "Now salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ have come, for the accuser of our brethren, who accused them before our God day and night, has been cast down, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony." And ultimately, many of these people would die as a result. But the devil has come down having great wrath because he knows that he has a short time. And so, and you could read on the rest of that passage. So we see this timeline of the devil, an exalted angel. Ego got to him. He starts trying to wheel and deal and get more power, cast to earth, and one day will ultimately be destroyed. So those are some of the passages to look at, just to get the big picture. And we want to zoom in a little bit more. The next thing I have on your outline is, what's the devil's agenda? What's he trying to do? Because he knows, he's smart. He knows that he's been cast out of heaven. He really can't possibly believe that somehow he is going to still become greater than God. He blew that. That didn't happen. That didn't work. And now he knows that his doom is sealed. So what's he still trying to do? And in 1 Peter 5:8, Peter talks about your adversary, the devil, is roaming around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Ultimately, his agenda is to try to destroy you, is to try to mess you up, is to try to rob the quality of life that you can have. If you are a Christian, he can't take your soul, but he would love to chew you up and spit you out. He would love to cause you to be confused, to cause you to lose your joy, to cause you to not experience peace. As long as he's chasing you and you are obsessed with him, well, he can take away as much of the quality of your life as he can. But everything that he does is basically meant to hurt people. Now, what are his tactics in trying to destroy people? And he has several. The center of it there in John 8:44, Jesus tells these guys that they're liars and that they're the children of Satan, who is the father of lies. You could look that verse up later if you'd like. But ultimately, Satan's main tactic is to fool people. His main tactic is to tell lies. God is truth. The truth of God sets us free. The devil hates the fact that we are free and he isn't. So anything that he can do to lie to us, he gets in our head. The devil is actually an illusionist, like a magician in Las Vegas, someone who just pretends really well. And if he can get in your head, if he can make you believe things that aren't true, then again, he can be destroying you from within. He can be hurting and wounding you. Over in Acts chapter 5, when Ananias and his wife Sapphira had sold a piece of land, and they came forward to the church and said, "We're giving all the money from the land that we sold to the Lord." But they lied, and they held some of the money back and only gave some of the money. And the apostles addressed them. And one of the things that Peter said, you know, is that you've lied to the Holy Spirit. But he said, Satan filled your heart so that you lied to the Holy Spirit. Not only is everything that the devil says a lie, but every time we lie, we are playing into his hands. He loves to see us live in an illusion. He loves to see us live a lie. See, because there's no reason for us to lie as Christians. We have been forgiven. Jesus died for us, forgives every sin that we will ever commit for free. There's no reason for us to pretend. But whenever we're pretending, we're playing into his hands, because pretending makes you crazy. Pretending makes you miss out on all of the goodness of God's grace. And so as the father of lies, that's something that he just loves to do. But also in, and you can turn over to 2 Corinthians 2:11. And if you just want to jot these down, you can turn to them later. I'm going to read it to you. But Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 11. Well, in verse 10, he's talking about forgiveness. And he says, "Now whom you forgive anything, I also forgive. For indeed, I have been, if indeed I have forgiven anything, I have forgiven that one for your sakes in the presence of Christ." That is the kid that in 1 Corinthians, Paul had said, kick him out of the church because he was committing incest until he would repent. Now apparently he had repented, and Paul says, forgive the guy, lest Satan, look at verse 11, lest Satan should take advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. One of the favorite tactics of Satan is to keep us from forgiveness. And often people do horrible things to us that we can justify and say, I don't need to forgive that. I don't want to forgive that. Well, who wins when we don't forgive? We certainly don't. We end up giving somebody that we're bitter against free rent in our head because we won't release that. So they continue to control us long after they really don't need to. Forgiveness is not for the person who committed a sin. Forgiveness is for us as we forgive. And it's really important for us to understand that we will begin to lose our joy. The joy of the Lord is your strength, as Nehemiah said. We get the life sucked out of us if we get bitter, if we don't forgive people. It's one of the devil's favorite tactics. To keep you from forgiving, to tell you, oh, that isn't right what they did. See, that's true, but that's a partial truth. And then he says, you shouldn't forgive them. And so we somehow feel like we are doing the right thing by holding an offense against someone. And the devil's just, he loves it, because that destroys us from within. And this lousy, roaring lion that wants to destroy us would love to do the job from the inside out. And a lack of forgiveness does that. But also over in Ephesians chapter 4, Ephesians 4 verses 26 and 27, Paul says this. Well, in verse 25, therefore, putting away lying, let each of you speak truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Truth and lies, remember? Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil. So not only is a lack of forgiveness a tactic of the devil, but anger is a tactic of the devil. And we need to really be cautious. When we see ourselves in a situation and we're like, I'm mad and I am bitter and resentful, the devil is just going, this is great. This is awesome. Because those are the kinds of behavior that destroy people from inside. And he doesn't have to do anything to do it. He just, you know, throws little lies out there, gives us suggestions, and we sucker for it. Now, another thing that I wanted you to notice, so in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, and this is something that often throws us off. When we talk about the devil, we think of all the caricatures of him, and you know, or maybe you think of some evil rock star, or you think Ozzy Osbourne biting the head off of a dove, or you know, something like, oh yeah, the devil, he's this weird evil guy. But look at 2 Corinthians 11 and verse 14. He says, and no wonder, he's talking about false prophets that act like they're apostles. And no wonder, for Satan himself transforms himself into an angel of light. Satan isn't the weird, you know, guy that pop culture will tend to make him. He's not, You know, he doesn't look like Mick Jagger on a bad day. He's an angel of light. His demons do that as well. Nobody would sucker. There are a handful of people who, like, oh, I worship the devil, and they get into all this weird stuff. But that's not the way most people are. Most people are like, that's too weird for me. That's crazy. So what the devil does is he makes himself very attractive. The devil would probably look more like some syrupy pop singer. I'll pick on one who's dead, because nobody's going to hopefully be offended, but I always felt like John Denver singing about, you know, God in nature, probably more of a threat in a way to people's souls than Mick Jagger singing Sympathy for the Devil. I think even the devil, when he looks at these devil worshipers, he's like embarrassed. He's like, that's not going to work with most people. Are you kidding me? So he tends to come in a way that you wouldn't expect. He tends to work not in a spooky sort of way. It's not like a horror movie. He comes and works in subtle and clever ways. You know, one of the things that caused the holiday of Halloween to develop, you know, the night before All Saints Day, was that they would dress up in costumes like devils and ghosts and things like that, because they were making fun of it. They were just going, because of what Jesus did, because our loved ones, all saints, are now in the presence of the Lord, we can laugh at this kind of spooky stuff. We don't have to, you know, jump and feel our skin crawl because of some silly movie that, you know, makes us freak out. He comes and works in much more subtle ways than that. The devil is ultimately a really good humanist. He sounds, well, I shouldn't say, I was going to say he sounds like a Democrat, but that wouldn't be nice. But he sounds like somebody who's like, wow, you really care about people, don't you? Look at the way he was with Eve. Oh, come on. Let's get real. You're not believing that stuff, are you? And so that's who he is. It's different than we think. Now, he has a bunch of helpers, probably, if we're reading Revelation 12 correctly, a third of all of the angels followed him when he fell. And again, we saw that in Revelation 12. They are responsible for most of the battles that we are in, that we think are battles with people. Ephesians 6:12, Paul says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Our fight isn't with humans. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual wickedness in high places. And so he says, therefore, you need to take on the whole armor of God that you can resist these demonic powers. Demons are involved influencing society. Demons are involved creating the kinds of situations in the world that make it easy for people to do something other than trusting God. Our battle, when we think we're fighting with a person, you go home tonight and you start fighting with your husband or wife, or you're fighting with a friend at work tomorrow, or you had a thing today where, you know, there was road rage, somebody cut you off on the road. None of that. Ultimately, the problem is not people. The problem is there are these principalities and powers, the scriptures tell us, that like to divide people because, boy, Satan's scared to death when we support each other, when we love each other, when we forgive each other, when we release our anger. And ultimately, whenever we are fighting a spiritual battle, ultimately, and it's important for us to remember that. Now, demons are able to possess people, or literally the word is, rather than demon possessed, it's demonized. It's just one word. And there are, if you read the Gospels, you see throughout the Gospels especially, a few times in the rest of the New Testament, but by far most of it's in the Gospels, where Jesus or disciples would confront someone and a demon had literally taken over the personality of this person. The demon would speak through the person. And so, you know, that's something that was a reality then. It's still a reality today. I have dealt with people who are demon possessed, and it's very real. Now, let me say this though. The overwhelming majority of the people who people think they're demon possessed, they probably aren't. They probably are mentally ill. And you go, well, wait, why would delusional, you know, mental illness or schizophrenia, why would it look so much like demons? Well, we are complex beings, but I believe that there are certain neurological buttons that can get pushed in us, and sometimes they get out of whack. Because of the fall, we aren't perfect. And I think probably demons just know how to touch our neurology in a way that they can bring out similar sorts of symptoms as mental illness. So, I mean, and sometimes I don't know what I'm dealing with, and so I really pray. A couple of the ways to know what you're dealing with is, if it's a demon, it is subject to the followers of Jesus Christ. Over in Luke 10, when Jesus sent the disciples out to teach, they came back and they're like, whoa, the demons are subject to us. We were able to command them, and they would come out and they would stop. And of course, Jesus told them, big deal. Don't get all excited about the fact that demons are subject to you. Get excited about the fact that your name is written in the book of life. That's what's a big deal. That's what's eternal. So I've dealt with people who, and I have seen physical responses. And that's one thing. Somebody talking weird or something, I'm really not generally that suspicious that it's demonic, because people just do that when they're mentally ill. But if I see physical signs of it, as we saw in the Gospels, with somebody's throwing himself into the fire, or they're having some kind of weird powers or extra strength and things like that, sometimes you begin to wonder. One time I was talking to a woman who was demon-possessed, and as I was looking at her eyes, and I'm not going to tell a bunch of ghost stories. I could tell you a ton of them, but you know, we'll save it for the campfire. But the whites of her eyes started turning red, just moving straight up her eyes. And when half of her eyes were red, I said, I command you in the name of Jesus to release her eyes now. And they went white just like that. Just the line just drew right back down. Schizophrenia doesn't do that. When that happens, you know. Sometimes they'll know something that, you know, that you wouldn't ordinarily know. One time I was dealing with a person who was demon-possessed, and I didn't know her at all. Someone called me, and I came over there, and she knew nothing about me. It was the middle of the night. My wife was back at home, and so I'm addressing this demon, and the demon looked at me and started to laugh and said, Anne. And I'm like, just for a second, it was like, whoa, that's weird. And I've never had a person who's mentally ill come up with something like that they just didn't know at all. And again, that's the devil. He likes to scare you. He likes to make you feel, can't do it. I went home, Anne was fine. But, you know, they are subject to the followers of Jesus Christ, but they can make a physical manifestation within a body. It's very real. Again, I tend to think that there's a lot less of it, at least in our country. We see it a lot more in some other countries and some primitive civilizations, perhaps because of all their spiritism and stuff. I'm not sure exactly why. But it was very common in the Gospels, less common in the epistles, for sure. Something about Jesus being there that brought them out of the woodwork. And because, obviously, the devil was trying anything he could do to stop Jesus. If he could stop Jesus, that's why he tempted Jesus. So I suspect that that's one reason why it was around so much then, why probably less, you know, now for sure. Now, the question is, can a Christian be demon-possessed or demonized? And different people believe different things on this, certainly. Let me say, first of all, in the Bible, there was never somebody who believed in Jesus who was possessed. On the other hand, in life today, most of the people who are exhibiting demonic-inspired behavior are Christians, actually. There aren't a bunch of non-Christians who are, but there are a lot of Christians who are claiming to be demon-possessed. That makes me very suspicious when most of them are Christians, when in the Bible, none of them were Christians. But an important thing in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 16, and in 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 19, and then another place in 2 Corinthians, Paul says, your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, and God dwells in you. God is at home in you. So I don't believe, I certainly believe that demons can lie to us, demons can harass us, they can mess with us. We have to understand that. But in terms of coming in and living with us, no, I don't believe the Holy Spirit would share his temple with a demon. The first thing Jesus would do when he met somebody with a demon is he cast the demon out. And the disciples did that all the time. The one time they weren't able to do it, Jesus did it immediately and then said, sometimes some of these won't come out except by prayer and fasting. And so you might have difficulty throwing one out, but Jesus doesn't. And that's his house. He dwells with us. He is at home with us. So personally, I don't, you know, there isn't a verse that says Christians can't be demon possessed, but since nobody in the Bible who was a Christian was ever possessed, and since, you know, almost everyone in this world who is thinking that they're possessed are people who are Christians, because the Holy Spirit lives inside of every believer. The moment you accept Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit comes in to live within your life. And as a result, if you don't have the Holy Spirit, you're not a Christian. If you're a Christian, if you put your faith in Jesus Christ, I don't believe that a demon can come and live inside you. Can a demon harass you? Can a demon bother you? Of course, because he is behind every lie that is told. And so whenever you think a lie, when you hear a lie, when you begin to tell a lie, he's like, yeah, this is awesome. This is what he wants, because lies destroy people and he wants to destroy people. But he doesn't get all weird and mystical about it. Remember, most of what, and even today, most of what people claim are his powers. He apparently, according to the scripture, only has power to do stuff if God gives him permission to do it. Remember, he had to ask permission to even make Job sick and to cause those problems with him. So, nothing personal, but me and you, all of us, we're really no Jobs. I don't think God's bragging about me and like, hey, how about that guy? So, you know, it's not that he's, but he can pretend to be a magician. Magicians are amazing. They work by power of suggestion. And I mean, there are some evangelists and stuff that use that same kind of manipulation over people. And you, all you have to do is turn on Christian television and you see it a lot. And so the devil's able to do that. You know, they can look at, somebody can look at you and make a suggestion and you start, like I could, if I just kept telling you all the demon stories that I've seen, you'd start getting nervous when you go home, because it's like, but it's just it. It's not something to be afraid of. But if I started, you know, telling you right now that some of you, your stomach's tightening up a little bit. That's the devil. He's squeezing you. Some of you had a really horrible week, and he's working you over, and he can destroy you. And do you ever have hot flashes? That's hell. That's hard. You know, and you'd be like, whoa, I do feel kind of hot, and my stomach is constricting, and I... There you go. That's how he works. Satan and his demons, they don't have to be doing everything. All they want is for us to lose everything that God's doing for us to start to believe lies, and he's really good. It's important for us to know the end of Satan and his demons. In the short term, in James 4, verse 7, James says, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. As we resist the devil, instead of us being like, oh no, I'm afraid of the devil. I don't even want to talk about it. You know, there are some people who are like, oh, you know, you're going to talk about the devil this week. I'm going to be praying for you because you're probably going to, you know, probably one of your kids will die and everything. I'm not superstitious. Come on. I have the living God living in my life. This is his house. We're fine. The truth is the devil is afraid when we resist him. And we'll talk about how we can resist him a bit. But we can have victory over him, and we can have it now. But then in Romans 16:20, I love that verse. In fact, I'll turn over there and read it to you. And this is a verse that you should remember whenever you just start being afraid, and especially when you start feeling like you can't forgive, and you're angry, and you're just feeling like God's so far away from you. Paul says, as he's talking to these Christians and greeting them, he says, and the God of peace will crush Satan under your feet shortly. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. God's grace, what Jesus did on the cross, as God predicted in Genesis chapter 3, it crushed the head of the enemy. And for us today, he's saying, hey, the enemy may be lying, he may be doing stuff, but very shortly, he's going to be completely crushed, not just crushed under God's feet, crushed under your feet. You will walk on his grave. You will walk over him, through him, past him. As the grace of God becomes more and more of a reality in your life, he loses his power over you. And it's so important to remember that short term. But I always love, and sometimes I've read these scriptures to when I've encountered demons, and they really love it. Revelation chapter 20. And if I'm really feeling under attack and stuff, sometimes I'll remind myself of these things. And in Revelation chapter 20 and verse 3, in verse 2, the angel laid hold of the dragon, the serpent of old, who is the devil and Satan, in case you don't know who he is, like a bunch of names, and bound him for 1,000 years and cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal on him so that he should deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years were finished. But after these things, he must be released for a little while. So for 1,000 years during the tribulation, Satan is completely bound. But skip down to the rest of the story. Verse 7, now when the 1,000 years have expired, Satan will be released from his prison and will go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, whose number is as the sand of the sea. This is Satan's last stand. They went up on the breadth of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city, Jerusalem, and fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. The devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone where the beast and the false prophet are, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. That's where he ends, and he knows it. He knows the scriptures. He's done for. So all that's left for him is to sit there and pretend like nothing's happening, to try to take as many people with him as he can, because... And it's not because he can take our salvation. If we have trusted Jesus Christ, we are absolutely secure in him. But what can happen is, if he steals our joy, if he causes us to always be, you know, angry or stressed or feeling defeated or denying God's grace or feeling guilty about things that he's already forgiven us for and things like that, what happens? The joy of the Lord is your strength. If he can take your joy, he's got your strength. And what does that do? When I lose my joy, I become less effective at sharing his grace and his love with other people. And so he can, in some respect, prevent other people from being saved if he can take God's saints, those who have trusted in him, and take us off our game. But ultimately, he's going to be destroyed, and he knows it. There will be people who choose to go with him. Over in Matthew 25, in the Olivet Discourse, when Jesus is talking about the final judgment, when it's the judgment of the sheep and goats, and he says, to those on my right hand, you will enter into heaven. But to those on my left, those who have lived for themselves, those who have denied the truth of Jesus Christ and who he is, they will go to a place of everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. God did not prepare hell for people. God doesn't want any people to go to hell. But if people insist on rejecting what Jesus has done for them, then he will allow them to join the devil and his angels in their eternal home. There are some people who wonder, well, is hell like forever? Does it make sense for somebody to burn forever and ever? I trust God to do the right thing for sure. But when it starts talking about it's everlasting, that, you know, the pain, their torment will go up forever and ever, ages upon ages and everything, that sounds to me like the devil and his angels are going to live forever in hell. And people who don't want Jesus, after he's done everything that he can to draw them to himself, they get to join him there. Now, I want to kind of wrap this up with a quick discussion of, in practical terms, about how do you deal with temptation? How do you deal with the fact that we're always wanting to do stuff that we don't even want to do? Like, you know, like Paul says in Romans, man, I do the things I don't want to do, the things I want to do, I don't do. How does that happen? And how do we lose these battles so often? And what can we do about it? Most temptation, generally throughout church history, people have said that temptation comes from the world, the flesh, and the devil. That was Thomas Aquinas said at the Council of Trent, established at the Book of Common Prayer, says that as well. But over in Ephesians chapter 2 is a biblical place where we see these three sources, because Paul said in Ephesians 2 verse 1, and you he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world. There's the world. According to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. That's the world, the devil, among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and the mind. So the world, the flesh, and the devil are basically three sources from which one of them or more of them causes us to be lured into doing things that are self-destructive and that are destructive of others. And so if we're going to understand spiritual warfare, and certainly we look at the whole armor of God. He says, we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, principalities and powers, so stand. And if you want, look up one of my studies on the whole armor of God, and I break those down for you. But it helps us to understand ultimately that, you know, there are these three directions from which things come. Now, turn in your Bibles over to 1 John chapter 2. And let me describe those three areas just briefly for you so you can tell the difference. Temptation from the world. The Greek word for world was cosmos. Cosmos means to be arranged. It's a system. It's where we get our word cosmetics. It's like, oh boy, I got to do something to fix this and make it arrange it enough so that it'll look better. It's the whole way that the world does things. It's the values of the world. Temptation from the world is temptation that gives us a desire to somehow fit in better with the worldly system, and usually it involves materialism. Temptation from the world is generally the temptation to want things to impress people. Okay? Temptation from our flesh is those physical drives that we have, the physical desires that God gives us, that each of them has a legitimate sphere for fulfillment within life following God. But when we want a shortcut and we just want to do what feels good right now, that's temptation from the flesh. Generally, when you see temptation from the devil, it revolves around pride, and it looks like I am questioning God. See, whenever you get puffed up with pride, what you're doing is you're saying, who God made me isn't enough. The gifts that he has given me are not enough. I want your gifts. I want to be you. I want to be somebody. And in the process, it's like, and it's the same thing with bitterness. It's like, you're basically saying, God screwed up. God didn't do what he should have done. I am questioning God. I am believing that somehow I am so important that something's wrong with God as to why he doesn't see how successful I ought to be. It's something that, you know, the devil, again, like I said earlier, what the devil does and what we see happen in mental illness quite often, very similar, because the narcissism that causes us to struggle with anything negative that happens in our lives because we really think we're better than that. We really think we don't deserve that. When you talk to people who are delusional, invariably they have these delusions of grandeur. They're falling into the same sin. Every one of us in our pride falls into the same sin that caused the devil to become the devil. So you have in 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17. So I'm in 1 Timothy. It'll help if I actually get in 1 John. You think the devil made me do that? I don't think so. 1 Timothy 2. By the way, I should have said too that I never say, I rebuke you, devil. I don't pray to the devil. I don't talk to the devil. Even Michael the archangel, Jude says, didn't say, I rebuke you. He said, the Lord rebuke you. So I let the Lord has plenty to say to rebuke the devil. I don't have anything to say to the devil at all. So verse 15, 1 John chapter 2, do not love the world, the cosmos, or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away and the lust of it. But he who does the will of God lasts forever. Look at that. The lust of the flesh. We talked about that. Some temptation comes from our physical drives. The lust of the eyes. How do I look? That's the temptation from the cosmos, from the system. And the pride of life, that's to put myself at the center, to make me more important than God, more important than everyone else too. That's what Satan loves to do. And he says, these are the areas of attack. Now, very quickly, turn over to Matthew chapter 4. Or click over to Matthew chapter 4. This is where Satan tempted Jesus. And it says, he fasted in verse 2, 40 days and 40 nights, and he was hungry. And then the tempter came to him and said, his first temptation, if you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread. He's like, you hungry? You could turn these rocks into bread. Lust of the flesh, right? And then Jesus answered, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God, quoting Deuteronomy. Then the devil took him up into the holy city, set him on the pinnacle of the temple, and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over you, and in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. He's like, dive down. Dive down, man, and all these angels are going to show up. It's going to look so cool. It's really going to be impressive. Temptation to impress. Temptation from the world. The lust of the eyes. And then ultimately, his final temptation took him up on a mountain and said in verse 9, all these kingdoms and all their glory, I will give you if you will fall down and worship me. Pride. I will promote you. You, if you will just bow down to me, I'm going to make you in charge of everything. That's what the devil always dreamed of having. And he's offering that, trying to appeal to the pride of the Son of God. Now, back in Genesis chapter 3, we see a similar narrative as the devil was lying to Eve. And look what she said about the fruit in Genesis 3 and verse 6. The woman saw that the tree was good for food, the flesh. That would taste good. And that it was pleasant to the eyes. I would look good with that fruit. And it was a tree desirable to make one wise. I'll be so smart, I'll be like God. The pride of life. There's nothing new under the sun. Those are the areas, the flesh, the world, the devil. These are the things that cause people always to fall. And we have to be able to be ready for that. And we need to defend ourselves in the way that the scriptures would tell us. Now, just really quickly, and you can jot down these verses. I don't remember if they're in your outline or not. In 1 John 2, verse 15, it says, love not the world, neither the things which are in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father isn't in him. So if your struggle right now is with worldly things, if it's with materialism, if it's with, you know, how do I look? Here's what he says. The problem is, if you don't love God enough, you will love stuff more. And so he says, don't love the system. Because if your life is dominated by a love for the world, your relationship with God and your love for him will deteriorate. So what I would suggest is if you're finding that your main area of attack from the enemy is in the area of the world, of stuff, of materialism, spend more time with him. Sometimes it's just good to get rid of stuff. I don't love the world, so I'm going to get rid of some stuff. And I'm going to spend more time with him than I've been spending getting more stuff. Than I've been spending obsessing on what people think of me. I want to know that my relationship with God is better than it's ever been. Because when you are not nurturing your love relationship with God, eventually there's going to be a vacuum and you're going to fill it with stuff. You're going to fill it with the worldly system. You're going to get caught up in everything that the world has to offer. And you can book it. It's predictable. If you find somebody who's obsessed with this world, if you find somebody who's obsessed with getting more, if you find somebody who's obsessed with getting political power or becoming more popular or, you know, putting their selfies, you know, online so everybody can see, here, look at me, here's me here, here's me here, here's me with this person. Hey, you can bank on it. This is a person who desperately needs to increase the time that they spend with God. Because as we love him more, and a part of that is just realizing I can be honest with him. He loves me so much, he forgives me. And being forgiven, God's grace makes us love him more. And the more we love him, as the old song says, turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. So spending time with God is a remedy to worldliness. Now, what about temptation from the flesh? 2 Timothy 2:22, Paul tells Timothy to, he said, Timothy, flee youthful lusts. Now you might go, well, thank God I'm not young anymore, so I don't have a problem with lust. No, actually, you still have a problem with lust when you get older. Part of your lust when you're older is you're jealous of people who are younger. You like to reminisce or tell stories about how bad you used to be. But when we are physically impacted and affected by temptation, just spending time with God will not fix that. Ultimately, you have to remove yourself from the situation. Like Joseph, when Potiphar's wife was hitting on him, he didn't just say, you know, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. He took off. He ran away. Sometimes you just have to run. Sometimes you just have to know, I can't put myself in certain situations because it makes me vulnerable to my flesh. And I just avoid those situations. Hey, if you're trying to lose weight, you don't go walk in a donut shop and just to smell. It's like, I just like to see those things dropping in the grease. Oh. And, you know, sit and think about, man, I remember when I could sit here and eat a whole box of Krispy Kreme donuts and I didn't gain a pound. I would just burn it right off. No, you don't go to Krispy Kreme. In fact, for me, if I'm feeling particularly vulnerable, I drive a couple blocks out of my way. I'll go down Forbes or whatever. So I don't even go by the place. And that's the same thing. Don't put yourself in a place where you're going to find that you are tempted. Put yourself, I sometimes talk to guys who struggle with like pornography and stuff, and I always encourage them, figure out where it is that you're looking at pornography, and when you are there, if it's in your restroom, wherever it is, put a Bible in there. Nobody ever yet lusted after somebody while they were reading their Bible. They're not looking and going, ooh, Delilah, she sounds hot. It's just, no. But you have to move yourself out of a situation, and sometimes you have to run. Sometimes you might have to quit a job so that you're not in a situation that you feel like you can't control. Sometimes you need to change friends. But ultimately, what you have to do is run. Figuratively or literally, you just need to run. That's the way we deal with the flesh. The devil, those questions about God, that obsession with pride, well, we saw in Matthew what Jesus did. He answered every question of the devil with a scripture. God's word arms us against the devil. Why? Because the scripture's the truth, and the devil is full of lies and other things. But it's like, the more we spend time in the Bible, seeing what the Bible says about God, then we feel like, I feel like he doesn't care, but the Bible says, cast all your cares upon him because he cares for us. I feel like I don't matter. I feel like it would be, my life would be better if I would just go sin. And I hear the scriptures just telling us he loved me so much that he died for me and that he has forgiven me. And so the scriptures are the way that we combat temptation from the devil. Always answer with the truth. Address a lie with the truth. The wrong strategy for the wrong temptation just doesn't work. If you are in a relationship and you're really tempted to get involved, you know, physically, for one thing, you don't go take a walk on a dark beach at night when no one's around. But you also don't wait till you're in a motel room sitting on the bed and go, can we just kneel down and pray and read the Gideon Bible before we do this? No, it's kind of too late. See, the Bible will not stop you from following your flesh. Running will stop you from following your flesh. At the same time, if you are feeling insignificant and you're desiring to be more and you're questioning God and who he is and his goodness, you can pray about it all you want. It's not going to get better. There are things that the scriptures tell us that we need to do. We need to get into the word for things like that. When I am getting caught up with materialism, it's not going to do me a lot of good to just run. You know, because you keep running, you're going to keep passing more stores, more stuff, more people that you want to impress. It's not going to do you a whole lot of good just to pray about it. What you need to do when you're attracted to the world is to combat the world with a relationship with the living God, to be in, you know, the Word for a relational purpose. When you're combating the enemy, I mean, one of the reasons why the Bible's so important is in all three of these areas it helps. It gives us examples and reminds us to flee those youthful lusts. It gives us the truth, the doctrine that combats the lies about the devil and that temptation that comes from him. And ultimately, as we look at the Word of God, we find out it's God speaking to us. It's our relationship with him. If we talk a lot at our church about just being balanced. And a part of that balance is, am I doing the things that will help me to win the victory over the world, over the flesh, over the devil? If I win in two out of three, he'll destroy me with the third. But if I am nurturing my relationship personally with him, if I'm spending time with God, making that a priority, and I'm studying his word, and I am seeing what it has to say and reminding myself of what it says about him and what it says about me, and then if I'm living my life in a self-disciplined way where I know how to run before it gets too difficult, when I recognize a problem situation and I just take steps to address it, balance begins to come into my life. And the devil will be so frustrated. And he's not going to just keep beating you up. There's plenty of people for him to work on. And there are people who think that, boy, the longer you walk with the Lord, the harder it is to fight the devil. I don't think so. As long as you do the basics, you will be fine. You don't have to be harassed by him all the time. It kind of works. When I was a brand new Christian, and maybe you've heard me tell this, and I've already gone over really late. I'm sorry. It's the devil. But I'd have this thought in my head. Dave, you're not a Christian. Because think of all the horrible things that you've done. And I would just lay in bed and I'd be tortured with memories of bad things that I had done before I gave my life to Christ. And I just felt so defeated. And I finally, on another week, we're going to talk about how to take our thoughts captive to deal with depression and things like that. But at this point, I decided every time I think that, what I'm going to do is I am going to picture myself in heaven with God. The devil is accusing the Father, and Jesus is standing there and saying, I died for that. That's gone. Dave has been forgiven. And then I picture myself just bowing down and praising him, and praise songs would just start going through my head. And it was amazing. That wasn't imaginary. That's totally real. I'm reminding myself of what the Bible says. And I'm taking myself to that place, using my ability to envision the truth. But you know what? Even today, I can't even remember the things that haunted me back then. I'm sure if I tried hard enough, but I don't try hard. I don't want to remember what a jerk I was. I'm already so aware of what a jerk I still am. But I was even worse of a jerk then. And I realized the devil just stopped reminding me of those things. Because he's like, every time I remind Dave of his sin, he's praising God for it. And he's not an idiot. He's just stuck. And he's stuck in the same groove doing the same stuff, and he's just like, eh, forget it. But then he figures, I'll get him some other way. I'll make him love nice vacations, or I'll make him want a better car, or I'll make him, you know, want to impress people, worry about what people think of him, or I'll suck him off into some sort of temptation to sin or whatever. And, you know, it's always something. But when we address these things in the way that the Bible tells us to, we can trample Satan under our feet. The only thing is, don't ever get prideful about the fact that you're managing him. Not because I'm afraid of him, I'm afraid of me. Because I realize that as soon as I am thinking, I got this, be careful. If anybody thinks he stands, take heed lest you fall. Pride comes before destruction, haughty spirit before a fall. As soon as I start thinking I'm doing really good against sin, I just committed the worst sin of all, and that's the sin of pride. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, He'll lift you up. Let's pray. Lord, when we read about the devil, we see the damage that he does. We see the horrible things that happen in our world that are totally inspired by him. We look at all the media and everything going on in the world. We don't even know what the truth is. They lie so much, and we know that the prince of the power of the air is working hard overtime. But I thank you that we have your truth, that ultimately we know who wins, and we know that you can give us victory on a daily basis if we live by your strategies for dealing with the devil's strategies. So keep us close to you. Help us to make devotions with you, our love for you, a priority. Help us to run from anything that would pull us into a failure of our flesh. And help us to stay in your word, learning your word, memorizing your word, so that we can have a ready defense against those crazy lies that are everywhere. Thank you for defeating the devil. Thank you for helping us know how to deal with him in the meantime. The victory is all yours. Please protect us from our own pride, from us becoming like him. Lord, everyone in this room is fighting a different battle. We've all got stuff. We all are under attack. Help us to stay close to you and to use the weapons you've given us. The weapons of our warfare aren't carnal, but they're mighty, and they will tear down strongholds. Arm us, equip us as we take on all of those weapons in the armor of God, the truth girding our loins. Lord, everything, our salvation, protecting our head, our helmet, our feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, the breastplate of righteousness, doing the right thing, praying always and using your word, the sword of the Spirit. May we live this life as a testimony of the victory that belongs to us because we belong to you. In Jesus' name, amen. One more thing, if you're here and you've never actually given your life to Jesus, you're like, I don't know, I feel like I've been losing this war and I'm not sure what I can do about it. You could accept him tonight. The victory can be yours. And so if you're just not sure where you stand with God, come on down to the front. There'll be, or just grab anybody around you even. And they would love to pray with you so that your life could start over. We'll be down here if you have any questions or anything. And may God give you an awesome night. And I owe you 18 minutes. God bless.